The word purity and the concept of purity have fallen out of favor in today's society. Only the minority of couples are still pure when they get married, if they get married at all. Close to 50% of babies born in this country are born out of wedlock. Speech in public is not pure. Think of all the profanity that we hear. Companies are corrupt. Think of Volkswagen and Enron. Governments are corrupt. Just this week we had an example in Brazil. I could go on and on. God in our scripture verse is seeking the opposite of this world. He's seeking purity in his people. Our scripture verse, "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God." That is what he will bless. He will bless purity. Let's talk about it with an example of how we get there. So I have to digress for a minute and say, when I was in junior high school, believe it or not, I was on my junior high basketball team, and I was not very good. But I would daydream all the time, and I would daydream that it was coming down to the final moment, the game was tied, I had the ball right before the buzzer, and I would sink the shot, my team would win, and people would lift me up on their shoulders and carry me around. It was really a very, it was a really good daydream, okay? I really enjoyed that daydream. So it made me feel like I was worthwhile, you know, that I was somebody that deserved to be respected, somebody who maybe was even talented. Well, to tell the truth, as I said already, I was not very good in basketball, and I didn't even start on my junior high basketball team, and I left basketball to become the editor of my high school newspaper, okay? I was a little bit more, that was a little bit more my strength. In his book, The Spirit of the Disciplines, theologian and Baptist minister Dallas Willard writes about how it is the tendency of young people to idolize sports figures and to try and imitate their actions in the game. Okay, so you know what I'm talking about. They try and behave just as their sports hero does. They try and make their moves just the way the sports hero does. They try and dress the way their sports hero does. They might hold their hands when they're shooting foul shots just like their sports hero does. And the problem with all of this, as we know, is that young people will not succeed like their sports hero if all they ever do is try to be like him in the game. Right? A star performer does not achieve his excellence by trying to perform a certain way only during the game. Instead, as Willard writes, it's the performer's overall life of preparation of mind and body that provides the basis for being able to perform well in the game, for having those automatic reflexes, those quick responses that will distinguish a sports hero in the game. So the exquisite moves that we see, the amazing timing and coordination that an athlete displays, are not produced and maintained by the short hours during the game. It's the long hours of preparation and practice with the proper diet, exercises for specific muscles, enough rest, all of those things go into having the sports hero perform outstandingly during the game. Well, in life, as in sports, a successful performance at a moment of crisis rests largely and essentially upon the depths of a self wisely and rigorously prepared in the totality of his or her being. To the point of our sermon today, a Christian who hopes to be able to act in the manner of Christ when put to the test cannot reasonably hope to do so without the appropriate exercise in godly living. Furthermore, the scripture reading for today calls for a superlative godly living, being pure in heart, and it results from a life of preparation. So to understand this scripture verse for this sermon, I want to examine four questions. First, I review why is the heart important? Second, what does it mean to be pure in heart? Third, what is the promise for those who are pure in heart? And then relevant to our analogy to a sports hero who performs amazingly in the game, how can we become and continue pure in heart throughout the course of our life? Okay, so why is the heart important? Jesus was concerned with the heart because he knew that one's heart determined what a person said and did. In Matthew 12, we read, "For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. A good man out of the treasure of his heart brings forth good things, and an evil man of the evil treasure brings forth evil things." Jesus rebuked the Pharisees because he knew what was in their hearts, and he knew it was wicked. He said to them, Now you Pharisees make the outside of the cup and the dish clean, but your inward part is full of greed and wickedness. And he called the Pharisees out for thinking that it was enough to have a good external appearance. He said, "Foolish ones, did not he who made the outside make the inside also?" And we know from Proverbs 4:23 that out of the heart springs all the issues of life. It's not enough to look good on the outside. Appearances can only be kept up for so long before the truth about a person is known. God knows our hearts, and Jesus came into the world to cleanse our hearts. In Matthew 15:18, Jesus said, "But those things which proceed out of the mouth come from the heart, and they defile a man. For out of the heart proceed evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornications, thefts, false witness, blasphemies. These are the things which defile a man. But to eat with unwashed hands does not defile a man." In the Beatitudes, of which our scripture verse is the sixth, and in Jesus' teachings as a whole, John MacArthur says that Jesus went straight for the heart. Jesus went straight for the heart, identifying first the fact that salvation or Christianity is something that happens to us at the very center of our being and makes us a new creation. It controls everything we are at the innermost part of our being and flows out from that point. Jesus was not interested in external religion. He was not interested in formal religious ceremony any more than God was. He was not interested in superficial works with wrong motives. He was interested in pure, transformed hearts. He characterized the Pharisees as sepulchers or graves painted white on the outside, but inside full of dead men's bones. So in this context, what does it mean to be pure in heart? So the answer to this question requires some background. How can the heart, which as Jeremiah says is deceitfully wicked, be pure? This Beatitude verse is an antithesis. The irony is that the only way to have a pure heart is to realize that you have an impure heart. It takes a supernatural work of God in our lives for us to be pure in heart. It's folly on our part to think that a person can merit, can own his own merit before God. The verse tells us that only through purity can a person see God, but all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Jesus says that it's not the intellectual who is blessed, but the pure in heart. The Christian faith, writes English pastor D. Martin Lloyd-Jones, is not a matter of the right education, intellect, or doctrine, but is a matter of the condition of the heart, the character of the person. A man may be very intelligent and highly educated and an utterly wicked person, not exactly pure in heart. As Lloyd-Jones wrote many years ago, a Christian is someone before he does anything. It all starts with who we are, and who we are is determined by the purity of our hearts. So in his commentary on the book of Matthew, 17th century minister and early Reformed theologian Matthew Hugh Henry wrote that the most comprehensive character of the blessed is that they are pure in heart. True religion consists in heart purity. He was quoting James chapter 1, verse 27, that says that true religion is to keep oneself unspotted from the world. Those who are inwardly pure show themselves to be under the power of pure and undefiled religion. True Christianity lies in the heart, in the purity of the heart, the washing of the heart from wickedness. The prophet Jeremiah says to Jerusalem, "O Jerusalem, wash your heart from wickedness that you may be saved. How long shall your evil thoughts lodge within you?" Like Jesus, Jeremiah understood that for us to have pure hearts, we needed to cleanse our thoughts and attitudes from sin. So continuing on the importance of purity of heart, commentators have written, "The heart must be pure in opposition to mixture, an honest heart that aims well, and pure in opposition to pollution and defilement." So purity of heart is the opposite of a polluted heart, a defiled heart, a heart that's mixed, a heart that's muddied, a heart that's adulterated. The pure heart is free from filth or sin. The heart must be kept pure from fleshly lusts, all unchaste thoughts and worldly desires, from all filthiness of flesh and spirit, all that which come out of the heart and defile the man. The heart must be purified by faith and entire for God. Our hearts must be presented and preserved as chaste virgins to Christ. So to be pure in heart requires us to overcome our inherited sin nature. Jesus is our role model. First, to be pure requires us to be single-minded in our devotion to God and to obey God's will for us. Jesus was pure in heart and is our example. He was wholeheartedly and single-mindedly devoted to God and doing God's will. He told us that many times and in many ways. In the Sermon on the Mount, he said, "No man can serve two masters, for he will either hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon." In John chapter 8, Jesus explained to the Jews that he had not come to the earth on his own, but to honor God his Father. He said, "For I've come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me." And the single-mindedness of the Christian is exemplified in the greatest commandment that Jesus taught. "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind." And in Philippians chapter 2, Paul wrote of Jesus, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. And being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross." And the Apostle Peter wrote, "Therefore, since Christ suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same mind. For he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh for the lust of men, but for the will of God." Jesus came to do God's will. The Danish philosopher Soren Kierkegaard said to be pure in heart is to will one thing. And that one thing is the reign of God in our lives. The second aspect of being pure in heart that Jesus exemplified is that he was without sin. In 1 Peter 2, we read, "For to this you were called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that you, that is we, should follow his steps, who committed no sin, nor was deceit found in his mouth, who when he was reviled did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but he committed himself to him who judges righteously. He bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sins, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes we are healed." So our goal is to continue to grow in spiritual maturity and to persevere in faith and be obedient to God the way Jesus did. In Revelation 22, Jesus testifies that the blessed in heaven are those who do God's commandments, that they may have the right to the tree of life and may enter through the gates of the city. In Revelation 21, John notes that there shall be by no means enter into heaven anything that defiles that which is impure or causes an abomination or a lie, but only those who are written in the Lamb's book of life. So to be pure in heart means to follow Jesus' example and to resolve to cease from sin. Our hearts need to be single-minded in our devotion to God, and we should no longer live for our sin, but like Jesus, our goal should be to live to do God's will. So there are three ways we can grow in purity of heart. So the first way is to diligently seek to know God's will by studying his word. You cannot be pure in heart if you do not know God's word. You cannot be pure in heart if you do not know God's word. Paul tells us in 1 Thessalonians that God's word works effectively in us. Jesus prayed for his disciples and also for all believers that God would sanctify them, make them pure in heart through God's word, because God's word is truth. It is for good reason that the psalmist wrote, "Your word I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you." Sinning is the opposite of purity. Proverbs 8 says that knowing God's will through his word is possible. Lady Wisdom in Proverbs says, "I love those who love me, and those who seek me diligently will find me." To diligently seek God is to study and study his word. Lady Wisdom continues in Proverbs 8:34, "Blessed is the man who listens to me, watching daily at my gates, waiting at the posts of my doors. Whoever finds me finds life and obtains favor from the Lord." Paul wrote to Timothy regarding the charge he had given him to minister in Ephesus. "Now the purpose of the commandment which he had given him to teach in Ephesus is love from a pure heart, from a good conscience, from sincere faith. Note the teaching of the word of God produces a pure heart which loves God." Peter wrote that we are to long for the pure spiritual milk of the word by which we grow. If you do not know God's word, you cannot be pure in heart. And if you're not pure in heart, you cannot experience the full blessings of God. There are no shortcuts and no other options. Jesus said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, you will ask what you desire and it will be done for you. And Jesus was describing a blessed state in which our prayers are answered. So I want to sort of tell you, I don't know if you've ever gone to movie theaters, and if you're aware of the fact that movie theaters flash messages you in a subliminal way. It's a flash that's only like 1/20th of a second. And in the movie theaters, what do you think they're flashing at you? Popcorn. Pictures of popcorn. Why are they flashing pictures of popcorn at you? Because they want you to go to the stand and buy refreshments and buy popcorn, right? How much does a tub of popcorn cost? $3.50 or $5? How much does it cost them to make it? Maybe 50 cents, right? So there's a lot of profit in selling popcorn. Well, I am giving you a subliminal message. Maybe it's not so subliminal message, right? To become pure, you have to know and obey God's word. That is my subliminal message that I'm sort of trying to sneak in there at you, okay? Now, knowing God's word makes us aware of how much we are sinners and how much we need to repent. When we become aware of our sins, we need to confess them to God, repent, and ask for his forgiveness. In Psalm 51, which I read in our confession of sin, David wrote that a humble and contrite heart God will not despise. He prayed that God would create in him a clean or a pure heart and renew in him a steadfast spirit. David begged God to allow him to stay in his presence and not to take the Holy Spirit from him, the way he had seen God take the Holy Spirit from King Saul. God wants us to have a tender conscience so that when we sin, we immediately realize it and ask for God's forgiveness. If we find our thoughts wandering and thinking about things which we know would not please God, we need to immediately jump on the situation and ask God for help to redirect our thoughts away from the sinful or potentially sinful thing we've been thinking about, whether it is lust or anger or greed or something else sinful. In such situations, I found it helpful to pray Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. Whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there's any virtue and if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. So when you find your mind straying, when you find your mind thinking about something that you know would not be pleasing to God, then develop a reflex verse that you say to yourself to get yourself redirected back on the right course and think about what that verse says. And if you think about it, Jesus did that in Matthew chapter 4, right? The devil came up to Jesus and tried to lure the devil away with power or with things that are really, you know, he could rule over all these kingdoms, or he could have this bread to eat, or he could have this or that. And what did Jesus do? Three times in Matthew chapter 4, Jesus said, "It is written." Jesus quoted God's word back to the devil to prevent Jesus himself from being tempted and to drive the devil away. So we cannot allow ourselves to habitually dwell on sinful things without repentance and still be pure in heart. John wrote in 1 John, "These things I have written to you so that you may not sin." So God's word gives us the power. You know, if we call on God and ask for God's help and repent of what we're doing, God's word gives us the power so that we can resist sin and we can be pure. And just along that same line, John MacArthur notes that we are not powerless against sin. Sin can and should be conquered through the power of the Holy Spirit. It's really very interesting that today is Pentecost Sunday and we're talking about how the Holy Spirit filled the early believers, because we're talking also about how the Holy Spirit can fill us and lead and guide us if we practice these spiritual disciplines. And of course, we'll come back to the thing that Dallas Willard was talking about the young man who wants to copy his sports hero. There are certain things that we can do to exercise ourselves to godliness, as Paul wrote to Timothy. So when we promptly confess our sins to God, ask for his forgiveness, and determine to obey his word, we can, through the power of the Holy Spirit, become pure in heart. Not only John, but James teaches us the same thing. He instructed us to resist the devil, and the devil will flee from us. Draw near to God and he will draw near to us. We can draw near to God by quoting his word when we are tempted. I gave you an example of that. Those who are pure in heart draw near to God, and God draws near to them. James continues, cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. So when you humble yourself, when you have that humble, contrite spirit that Dave was talking about, when you realize you're not where you should be, and you confess that to God, this verse says that he will lift you up. He will bless you. So the pure in heart are led by the Holy Spirit because they have not quenched or grieved the Spirit by their disobedience to God's commandments. The third way we can become pure in heart is to do what we know is right. We know what is right from God's word. Jesus told his disciples, you are already clean because of the word which I've spoken to you. Notice again the relationship between knowing God's word and being pure in heart. The pure in heart love Jesus, understand his word by the illumination of the Holy Spirit, discern the lies of the devil, and do those things which are pleasing to him. The pure in heart have an arm's length relationship with the world. As we noted, James wrote that pure worship is to keep oneself unspotted by the world. He said that friendship with the world is opposition to God. Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. John wrote not to love the world or the things of the world because the things of the world are temporary and passing away. He said that he who does the will of God abides or continues forever. Paul also wrote to the Colossians to set their minds on things above, not on earthly, worldly things. And in Romans, Paul wrote that those who seek to do the will of God do not conform themselves to the world. The pure in heart are wholeheartedly devoted to pleasing God and obeying his word, not going along with the ways of the world. Like Jeremiah, God's word is the joy and rejoicing of their hearts. The pure in heart fear God in the sense of giving God proper reverence because of who he is and what he has done for them. The pure in heart obey God's word. There's that subliminal popcorn for you again. Okay? The pure in heart obey God's word. Said another way, the pure in heart maintain an eternal perspective. We look forward to the day of the Lord when Jesus will come again. At the end of 2 Peter, the Apostle Peter writes, we look forward for new heavens and a new earth in which righteousness dwells. Therefore, beloved, looking forward to these things, be diligent to be found by him in peace, without spot or blemish, without impurity, right? We want God, when he comes, to find us to be pure. And he says, Peter says, beware lest you fall from your steadfastness, being led away by the error of the wicked, but grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And in Psalm 101, David resolved to be pure in heart. He would not set anything wicked before his eyes. He behaved blamelessly. He would not tolerate a slanderer or one who had a proud heart. And he lived with those who were faithful in the land. He said that no one who practices deceit or tells lies shall dwell within his house. That's interesting when you think about company you might have. Or even what you might be watching in social media or in the internet or even, you know, on a DVD. You know, David said that he did not allow any deceit or wickedness within his house. And in 1 Peter 1, we learn God has given us everything we need to be pure in heart and see him. It takes effort and discipline, but we will gain entrance to the divine kingdom in which we will see him. So the third thing is, what is the promise? That, remember in the beginning I said there are four questions we're going to answer. What is the promise for those who are pure in heart? This is sort of the good news, right? What is the promise for those who are pure in heart? Well, the pure in heart are blessed. Our verse clearly tells us the pure in heart are blessed. The pure in heart are spiritually happy, okay? In Psalm 73, David wrote, truly God is good to Israel, to such as are pure in heart. Psalm 24 is said to be the closest thing in the Old Testament to the Beatitude, you know, Matthew 5:8 that we read, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. And Psalm 24 goes, blessed are the pure in heart. David wrote in Psalm 24, who may ascend into the hill of the Lord, or who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted up his soul to an idol, nor sworn deceitfully, he shall receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. So David is telling us that those who are pure in heart shall receive righteousness from the Lord and blessing. So with a pure heart, the blessed receive the most comprehensive comfort they can receive. They shall see God. As Matthew Henry says, they shall gaze with wide open eyes at something remarkable. And that's the meaning of the Greek word for see. Matthew Henry says, it is the perfection of the soul's happiness to see God. Seeing him as we may by faith in our present state is a heaven upon earth. And seeing him as we shall in the future state is the heaven of heaven. So, you know, people have said that the closest thing we can come to heaven is really being in God's presence, feeling his spirit leading us here on earth. That's sort of the joy that we will experience in heaven all the time. But it's a, you know, it's a thing that comes and goes as we're filled by the Spirit and led by the Spirit and as we bear fruit in the Spirit. To see him as he is, face to face and no longer through a glass darkly. To see him as ours and to see him and enjoy him. To see him and be like him and be satisfied with that likeness. And to see him forever and never lose the sight of him. This is heaven's happiness, and this is the thing we touch on as we are pure, as we act in a pure manner, as we don't sin here on earth. So the happiness of seeing God is promised to those and those only who are pure in heart. So that's that happiness of seeing God here on earth. So the happiness of those who are pure in heart is that we will be allowed to be in the presence of God. And as a result, we will experience the peace and trust that we have from God in all circumstances. It's a sort of warm and cozy and wonderful relationship that we can feel. Remember, God says, never will I leave you nor forsake you. Never will I break a promise or let you down. So we can be in a state in which the Holy Spirit is working in us to sanctify us and separate us to God. And we can receive the fruit of the Spirit who gives measurably good things to us. So in John 14:21, Jesus said, he who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. And he who loves me will be lit by my Father, and I will love him and manifest, that's reveal, show myself to him. So the pure in heart, those who are obeying God's word, are blessed by seeing God, experiencing him in their inner being, and being at peace by the power of the Holy Spirit. Come what may. Think about it. Being at peace by the power of the Holy Spirit. Come what may in our present life. That sounds really good. And that is something that we can attain to by this practice of wanting to know God's word and obey God's word and having God's word implanted in us so that we know when we start to go off course, God's word and the Holy Spirit using God's word can bring us back to the right path. So then we get to the final thing. How can we continue pure in heart? And I'm going to give you four very quick things. The first thing is know that we can't do it on our own strength, right? We can't be pure in heart on our own strength. Proverbs 20, verse 9 says, who can say, I've made my heart clean, I'm pure from sin? It is not what we do. It is the blood of Christ that cleanses us from all sin. God, who knows the heart, purified our hearts through faith. So we need to persevere in faith and trust in the grace of God. Be empowered by the Holy Spirit, not by grieving, quenching, or resisting him. That's the first thing. So the first thing is, know that we can't do it on ourselves, but we have to claim the promises of God in Christ. The second thing is, we have to be grieved when we do sin. We need to be grieved. And because we're grieved, then we need to promptly repent and confess our sin and make restitution to God and others as needed. Like David in Psalm 19, ask God to show you your sins every day so that you do confess them. You know, it says in Psalm 19 towards the end, who can discern his faults? You know, and then he said, God, acquit me of my hidden faults that I don't see. The third point is to guard your heart by being grounded in the word and prayer. Jesus told us we are clean through the word which he spoke to us. Pray to know God better and better and to be continually aware of his presence so that you will not sin. Fear God and be afraid to sin. You know, if you think about my exhortation, at some point Solomon forgot to fear God. He let his heart be turned away from God, but we don't want to do that. We need to fear God and be afraid to sin. And then fourth, remember every day that one day we will be face to face with God. One day we will be face to face with God. We will all stand before his judgment seat. So live each day, and this requires training and exercise and discipline. I admit that. Live each day with the mindset, with this mindset that one day we will face God. And we have to live life one day at a time, because if you think, oh man, I can't think of living the next 30 years every day fearing God. No, just get up one day at a time and ask God to help you today. Lord, help me today to fear you and to know your word and to obey your word. So we want to seek each day to grow in the discipline of being godly. Each day, seek first the kingdom of God. Do not worry about tomorrow. Sufficient for the day is its own challenges. Hebrews 12 tells us, pursue peace with all people and holiness, without which no one will see the Lord. So let me remind you where we began. We're seeking purity in our lives. In life, as in sports, success rests largely and essentially upon the depths of the self wisely and rigorously prepared in the totality of his or her being. Remember our sports hero, the sports hero who spent hours and hours and hours practicing free throws, right? He just doesn't sink free throws. He doesn't shoot 10 out of 10, sink 10 out of 10 free throws without practice. He spends hours and hours and hours practicing free throws. So I'm not calling you to practice free throws from the foul line. I'm calling you to the point of our sermon, which is to act in a manner consistent with Christ. And I've given you some pointers, if you will. That's a sports term, some pointers. Garrett, here's some pointers so that you'll be able to perform better in basketball, although I think baseball was Patrick's and your sports, right? Baseball was your sports. But for whatever we want to do, in this case, in the game of life, we want to excel. So a Christian who hopes to be able to act in the manner of Christ when put to the test in the course of life cannot reasonably hope to do so without the appropriate exercise in godly living. So our Beatitude reading for today calls for superlative godly living, being pure in heart, and it results from a life of preparation and constant spiritual discipline. Seeing the Lord is a result of doing the things day in and day out which make us pure in heart. Our aim in being pure in heart is to do the will of God, which is to obey his commandments and to refrain from sin. As Christians, we should live the remainder of life on earth pursuing the holy will of God rather than the ungodly lusts of flesh. We are blessed, enjoying a life inspired by being in the presence of God, if we do that. So let me say one more time, being able to live a life in which we exercise ourselves to godliness is by God's grace. We cannot do it under our own power. We call on God to enable us to grow in spiritual maturity every day. And let me close with 1 John 3, little children, let no one deceive you. He who practices righteousness is righteous, just as he is righteous. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this lesson from your word. We earnestly desire your blessings. Help us to love and obey your word so that we might be pure in heart and experience you in our lives every day. Grant that you might move in each of our hearts so that we, like Jesus, might be wholly devoted to you. In the name of Jesus, the one who came to do your will, we pray. Amen.